Hi. Is there anything you've done that you wouldn't have done before? Just like what you kind of regret or something, kind of like that.
Oh, that I wish I hadn't done? There's definitely things, but it's a tricky one because I'm the kind of geek where I think about, well, if I hadn't done that, then things wouldn't have ended up exactly as they are now, and I would have lost out on things that ended up being really good. So I don't know if it's actually true, but there are definitely times where I've made decisions in my life that I kind of, in retrospect, think are not very smart decisions. Like, when I first got sick, I didn't tell people, and I think that wasn't the smartest thing to do because, as you can tell, I like being open and honest with people, and I was always having to try to hide something, and that's a horrible feeling when there's something that's so significant in your life and you can't just talk about it, and we can't be open about it. And that's one thing that I think I've gotten much better about over the years, is just not, like, I'm a bit shameless. I just don't, there's no time to try to hide the end of a veneer of your question or something. I love it you guys are applauding, because I think we all know, and there's too common in this world that we're all trying to walk around going, no, I'm perfect, I got this. And it's just silly, because we all have stuff. There's always something. And just shouldn't get in the way. So I think that was, something that I wish, or in retrospect, I don't think was the smart thing to do.
So I have a weird answer, because what it was I always loved working on the show, and it was so much fun. I always was one of those people, I loved doing my own stunts and stuff, so that wasn't so hard. But what I was really hard was what I did to myself, because I didn't tell anyone that I had MS for years. So I was doing these episodes, and I'm just like, can I make it from here to the counter or whatever it is? Like, just the stupid motions and things, and trying not to look drunk, because I was kind of wobbly, and I think people thought maybe I was drinking or something, you know, like they didn't know why. And it was freaking hard, and there were many times I was going into the trailer in the back, I just barely make it, and I'm like hoisting my legs into the trailer and going in and crying, and like, so I made it really hard on myself, but for no reason, because it's the nicest set, and they were all, like, they would have gone out of their way to make it easy for me, so it's just a good lesson.
It's amazing that you did that, and like, that's what I've been learning, is like, at any given moment, somebody is doing something like that.
Yes.
Yeah.
Somebody's sitting there dealing with X, Y, or Z. Right.
Well, and I think, like, it's so brave to be so public about any personal issue.
To make that choice.
Yeah. Kim and I had this conversation not too long ago where I find sometimes when you are quiet, obviously you're protecting yourself, and there's a lot of things that you don't even understand. And then when you open up and you see the people that come to you, and you then are an opportunity to help others.
Yes.
When you feel so helpless yourself, and that's such the empowerment of not staying quiet, of having a voice.
Yeah. And it's also such a mistake to think that we don't own our own stories. In other words, I was so afraid that if I told that, then people would be sympathetic, and it would be all we were talking about, and they'd feel like I was the victim, and all these things. That's all a matter of, you control that. So when I finally started talking about it, I realized, well, that's not how I have to tell people about it. And therefore, it is now my story, and I can set a new example and be part of that for other people. So, yeah.
Hi, Rachel. It's really awesome to be here with you there.
Oh, I'm so glad you're here.
I just wanted to know, what's your favorite part about being a part of the Supernatural family, and is there anything you change about the experiences you've had because of it?
It's very hard to pick a favorite part, because it's all the little things. It's all the moments we don't really even notice that, like, I mean, we'll say that we have the kindest group of people ever. I just got helped out on stage by some of them. But But yeah, it was the feeling of being on a set where you just feel safe and good, and you know you have each other's backs, and there's nothing like that. And it's the same being in this group here, and going to the conventions, and you just know you have a bunch of people around who are loving and good, and are taking care of you, and you want to take care of them. It's hard to put that into circumstances or words, because it's a combination, it's an adding up of all of them. Does that make sense?
Yeah, sorry if my question...
No, it's a wonderful question. It's a wonderful question. Please don't say that. I'm not good at answering it, but but that doesn't mean it's a bad question. No, and I wouldn't change anything about it. Obviously, it's hard for me to get over, like, you know, being physically not as capable, and I was very worried about starting to come to these events when things were going wrong, because I thought one of the things I loved is there's so many strong, badass ladies in this group and on the show, and I wanted to be an example of that, and I was worried that seeing me, you know, weaker or something would undermine that, and it was so incredible to have a group of people that told me, no, you know, you're strong just for showing up, for being you, and I think we all need to keep telling each other that. So, yeah. I hope you have a beautiful day. Thank you so much.
Sorry, I just wanted to say you are such a huge inspiration to people with chronic pain.
Please don't wait, let's pause for a second. Please don't apologize. You were so beautiful. And, like, there's nothing I love more than, and you can tell, because I do it all the time, than blubbering and being honest and showing our hearts, and I think it's such a freaking beautiful thing. So, like, I just enjoy that. I love that we can touch each other in that kind of way. I think that's beautiful. So, yeah, so never apologize for that. Yes. No, I feel you, and believe me, I deal with it all the time, and it can consume you, and so there's like lots of tricks, and you have to find what works for you. One of the main things is like, don't be afraid of it. Just try as much as possible to find things that inspire you so much that it pulls you outside of it.
Yeah, you actually inspired me.
That's amazing! You rock. You rock. Yeah, it's a funny thing when you're dealing with chronic pain, just to find things that really, all of a sudden, like little things that maybe you used to kind of enjoy don't matter anymore, and you have to find things that inspire you a lot. And that's what, so if you find, if doing hair and finding that art and that beauty and aesthetic is what does it for you, just keep doing that and keep reminding yourself of that. And the other thing is, don't be afraid to be upset sometimes. You know, the way that I tend to do it is just my personality. I tend to kind of purge it really quickly and very dramatically when no one's looking. So, like when I'm alone in my room, sometimes I will just scream, literally, or throw something. Like, unfortunately, objects don't do so well around me sometimes. You have to, because it's hard and it wears at you. And the thing that's different about chronic pain is I used to always consider that I was a tough cookie. I could deal with a really high amount of pain for a short time. But with chronic pain, it kind of turns you into a baby, because over time, it's just like exhausting. And it never, you don't have that thing of like, if I just make it through, it'll go away. So you just, it can wear at you. So I feel you, but here's the thing is like, there is a respite, there is a stillness, there is something on the other side. Even though the pain is still there, there's a point you can get to, and I'm sure you've gotten to it, like when you're doing hair or something, and you're in that zone, and you're so taken up with your what's inspiring you and the beauty and all that, that you just, the pain starts to get really quiet. It's the best way to describe it. So just do what, you know, live loudly, do what drums out the pain as much as you can. And I just know that I think you're amazing.
How are you doing?
My question is, since this is supernatural and the writers can bring back anybody if they choose.
Yes.
If they resurrected Meg, how would you like to see her come back, and what kind of storyline would you like to, what direction would you like to see her character take?
That's amazing, but I leave it up to the brilliant writers and you guys, because that's one of the dream things about this show is I've always been pleasantly surprised. Like, I'm always, it's better than Christmas morning. Like, I'd rather just open the present and see what I get, if that ever happened. But I also freaking love the show, so I enjoy whatever direction they're going with any of the characters. I don't have expectation. But yeah, it'd be amazing to see what was happening with Meg next.
Would you come back to the show?
Absolutely. Yeah, no, I do whatever they ask me to.